Murray. So, you'll be wanting a new car then, eh?
Well, this could be your lucky day.
Yeah, but what about...
The new Metro and Maestro specials. Terrific value. Some very special ways to pay. And they've even given them both
a sunroof.
Ooh. But you'll have to hurry, Murray. They're going to go fast.
But isn't it...
Exactly, Murray. Less than any Fiesta. And Maestro special.
But I thought...
Absolutely, Murray. Less than any Escort. So, whichever you choose, it won't cost a mint, Murray. A Murray mint. Get it, Murray? Sorry, Murray.
Decorating's a real chore when you know the next chap is off sunning himself while you're stuck at home with primer, undercoat and gloss. Who needs all that? Branch paint or ranch stain will give your woodwork long-lasting protection in just one coat. And you a break.
Now's the time to order your solid fuel for winter because the summer price is right. Ask your coal merchant to come on down with your delivery before August the 31st.
There is a food for dogs that contains over 50% more meat than the best-selling tin dog food in Britain. Its name is Winalot Prime.
This Tuesday, Channel 4 begins a new series on the diverse and ever-changing city of Glasgow.
If Glasgow's going to be miles better, it's not to be a cosmetic job just to please the tourists. It's to be that everybody's community should be miles better.
It's too late for the industry. It's not going to come back. But is replacing the cranes with a plastic replica of Glasgow in a garden built in the docks the answer?
The unique face of Glasgow, revealed in a new series beginning this Tuesday at 9 on 4.
Four, salutary tale of two companies, one British, one Japanese, in Zen and the art of TV manufacture.
This is South Wales. The Japanese multinational Panasonic have built four factories here. They are here to beat EEC import tariffs and because it is parent company Matsushita's policy to penetrate every market in the world. They have brought employment to South Wales, but they have also brought something else, a new industrial philosophy, almost a Zen religion. The people of Wales who work for Panasonic have become its new disciples.
この七精神は会社の仕事をするという場合の
Sukamuni-san preaches the gospel according to Matsushita.
を示しておりまして、すべての我々の仕事の面にこの精神にのっとって活動する行動するあるいは考えるということで全部の面に生きているとこう言っていいと思います。
Our Matsushita seven objectives or principles were decided by our founder, Konosuke Matsushita. As these are our business principles, I believe they should be reflected in every aspect of life in our company, in our thinking, acting, decision making, and so on.
Miles from Osaka, but only 150 miles from Cardiff, is Acton, home of the last of the old British television manufacturers, Fidelity.
It's a red. Oh, don't miss it, it's a stunner.
February 1987. Fidelity's 600 employees are working flat out producing their most successful product, a 14-inch color television set that retails at less than £150. Back in 1984, Fidelity was absorbed into a large and very successful manufacturing group called Caparo. Caparo is owned by an Indian of the Hindu faith, a faith just as powerful as Zen, Suraj Paul.
The word religion has been misused. Religion, to me, is everyday life. And in the philosophy which I come from, the Hindu philosophy, it doesn't have religion as religion literally translated. The word we use for religion is called dharma, and dharma means duty. So your everyday life is a part of the religion, how you act with your relations, how you act with your superiors, how you act with your inferiors, how you act with your colleagues. All that is a part of religion.
Religious commitment is just what is needed at this end of the television market. There is fierce competition from dollar-denominated Far Eastern countries like Hong Kong and Korea. Today is the 10th of February, 1987. The pound is worth $1.53. If the dollar gets any weaker, it'll be cheaper for Fidelity to import their 14-inch sets than to make them in the Acton factory. Within months of Caparo's takeover, it was clear that faith would not be enough to lift Fidelity into the big league of manufacturers. Duty and commitment was what it needed. Suraj Paul appointed a manager trained at the Harvard Business School, Richard Hanna.
We don't as yet have the sort of attitudes, I think, throughout the whole operation which suggest that they really want to produce as much product as possible and get it right all the time. And when there's a problem of some kind, that you actually have caring managers, supervisors who listen to it and do something about it and get it fixed. I said that the whole effort is towards producing the high quality product and producing it at the lowest cost. It's those sort of attitudinal values, a culture, if you like, within the organization, which is not right and which has to change still. And I'm not sure it's just true of us. I think it's, to some extent, it's a contrast between a British factory, possibly, and a Japanese factory.
There may be contrasts, but in the end, only two things matter: the cost of the product and the profit it produces. Money and the value of money will be critical factors in the story of Fidelity. Jack Dickman founded Fidelity over 40 years ago, when Japan was an occupied country in ruins. Fidelity was a classic industrial success story of post-war Britain. Starting with a demob gratuity of £250, Dickman built the company into a £1 million business. In the consumer boom of the 50s, 60s and early 70s, Fidelity flourished, making competitively priced radios, record players and radiograms. The company managed to survive through the darkest years of Britain's recent industrial decline. Despite three-day weeks and cheap imports from the Far East, the Fidelity doors stayed open. When Caparo acquired Fidelity 4 years ago, after an aggressive and contested takeover, on paper at least, the company looked sound, if unspectacular. Chairman Sraj Paul quickly found that what looked like an attractive proposition was in fact exactly the opposite.
The interesting thing about Fidelity to us was that here was a company who was in a sort of a dog's end of the industry, but making £1.4 million profit. So when we paid £14 million for a company making £1.4 million profit, we thought we can only go further. Unfortunately, as soon as we got in, we found things very different than what they were looking from the balance sheets, etc. And we have been firefighting ever since.
It didn't take us long to discover the company had not been making money for a period of time. And that what we thought was a profitable venture, but needed in some ways more products, better products, because the quality wasn't very good, turned out to be a company that actually had a lot of problems because it wasn't making money. This was really because of a quality problem. And I would not like to say or give the impression that it's always the people in the factory that caused the problem, because it's not. It's management, really, at the top. I mean, if management doesn't care about quality, no one else in the company is going to care about it, because they're going to take the easy route out.
Hanna immediately initiated a quality control drive to restore the faith of the retailers. But he knew their loyalty was only as strong as the product. Taking a bold and expensive decision, he decided to restyle the successful but down-market 14-inch set with an upmarket image. Conran Associates were commissioned to design a dummy model to test consumer reaction. On July the 15th, 1987, market research results were revealed to an already overworked management team. So then we moved on and said, okay, well, what features... Fidelity's investment in the new Conran design had been tested by a further investment in market research. Bob Dance's company, Research Partners, held consumer clinics with potential customers.
There is a subjective view about how well the television is performing, and that clearly seems to be an important aspect of choice.
Do you think people are just thinking what to say, and the thing you say about a TV set is, I want a good picture?
Yeah, that happens
a lot,
actually.
Does that happen in real, when they really purchase, do they care that much?
When you ask them the question, yes, they say, oh, I need a good picture. When you actually go into it in a little more detail and say, okay, well, how do you decide what's a good picture? Then it really falls apart. They find it very difficult to actually tell you.
According to Dance, picture quality turns out to be a matter of taste.
In fact, when it comes down to choice, there is very little choice parameter that they can use. I mean, because if they see them in Dixon's, for instance, in a wall, I mean, it depends on the sort of reception that the shop has, the aerial and so on. And they're aware of that to a certain extent. The other interesting thing to point out before we move on to the Conran is your existing model, the existing Fidelity model. It does extremely well on most of these criteria.
Hanna was not impressed. Telling manufacturers what they already know is part of the art of market research. What he wants to know is, will the new set do the trick?
The Conran, on the other hand, is generally not... does not do quite as well.
The results are increasingly depressing. Conran's sharp and rational design is heading for rejection on the basis of a small cross-section of possible customers.
87% of our sample said that there was something that they particularly disliked about the set. Now, that's a very high score, and would suggest there is something deeply wrong with the design. If you look at what they're saying, it's again, I mean, at the risk of repeating oneself, it's coming out time and time again, but it's the bulky, boxy nature of the thing. They talk about the back as being bulky and so on, and it's an important characteristic because what they want to do is put it, in many cases, in two-thirds of cases, as we saw, they want to put it in a sort of nook or cranny in the bedroom. If it appears to be too bulky for that nook or cranny, then it could possibly be rejected. So, I mean, that is an interpretation, if you like, of these figures. But I'm reasonably sure that that was what was happening. They were looking at the way that back is designed and were saying things like, well, it actually looks bigger and bulkier than the normal sets. So by achieving that slimline design at the front, what you've actually done is accentuated the back, if you like.
If you're researching a totally new design, of which that one fits in, the type of approach that appears to be coming along over the next 2 years, the consumer is always relating to today's.
With 20 years' experience in consumer electronics, product planning director Richard May has his own interpretation of the results.
And the consumer pulls back from looking too far ahead. And I suppose we can relate it a little bit to the adverse comments that were made against the Ford Sierra when it was first launched. But it's becoming the trend that a lot of car design is going in now.
I think the market tends to be conservative too.
There's no reason why you can't make a good, well-designed product at a competitive price. You don't have to equate low price with either low quality or, you know, old-fashioned, poor design. And Conran was a step in the direction to try and show that we could have good design, be up with it, and still sell a competitive price. I think where we've fallen down is we've found we can't sell it at the price level that Fidelity is classified as at this point in time. So it's on the back burner.
Don't like it, sorry, Jim.
You don't like it.
By August, the Conran set had been abandoned. Hannah and his team decided to continue with plans for a 20-inch television set with revolutionary digital technology. Bill Eddington from the shop floor and designer Dave Edwards discuss a switch they like, which was taken from a competitor's product.
Who says this?
I think it comes off an Hitachi video. I'm sure it's off an Hitachi video.
This type of cannibalization is common in the electronics industry. Under Hanna, product design and manufacturing design are now high priority. Probably for the first time in the company's history, the drawing office becomes an important area.
We found we had to start right back at the product level, that inherently the products in many instances were not designed to be quality products. They were designed to a price and not for quality. But the key thing, I believe, is that quality is the cheapest route. That's the strange thing. A lot of people think, well, you've got to pay a premium to get quality. Actually, if you make a quality product, you're probably making the most cost-effective thing you can do. Because it does mean that you want to get everything, as I said earlier, right first time. And to do things right first time is usually a cheaper route than trying to fix up mistakes. You do have to have the attitude, and you do have to design the product from the word go, that it's going to be carefully tested for reliability and for good performance. If you do that, I think you'd build it on the back of an envelope, basically, if you had to.
I'll tell you what we'd do. If this is your bracket, right, we'd put a boss through it. Either acted as a guide, or you could use that as a screw fixing. So you either use that as a heat swage and that as a guide, or that as a screw fixing and that as the guide.
And if those bosses were tall enough, you may
be able
to use
a spy fix on them.
Put a spy fix on them.
So you've got three methods of fixing.
Right, so we can heat swage and spy fix or screw.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Right.
The old truism that time is money became the catchphrase of the Fidelity management. The pound was strengthening against the dollar, making imports from the Far East even cheaper. Fidelity's popular bread-and-butter line, the 14-inch colour television, was in the crowded, cutthroat end of the market. They had to look for new products.
The other thing, of course, is considering Fidelity's place, is that with Fidelity, we have never in the past led the market with a new product. We have tended to wait and come in downstream.
Satellite broadcasting is the future of television. It's September 1987, and Fidelity are discussing the possibility of being first on the market with an affordable satellite receiver package.
We've seriously got to consider whether we should come in and enter the market on day one, or that whether we make a conscious decision to say, no, let the other people be the founding fathers and let's come in to it.
The problem for Fidelity is that satellite receivers will certainly be in high demand, but when? Hannah's analytical Harvard background slices up the prospects.
And it's worked out penetration of number of sets sold in the market by number of weeks pay required to buy the set. Mm. And the shape of the curve, in every instance, the takeoff is exactly the same. It's product by product.
Yeah, obviously.
So you could argue that in satellite receivers, where they're hoping to have 400,000 receivers out before they start transmitting VSPs,
right,
it ain't going to happen, guys. We're going to have this slow takeoff. Mm. It's exactly the same time when your guys, the specialists, are going to be in the market. Then they're going to drop away, and the mass market will be several years down the road when it takes off. And we're going to be struggling, you know, in that short period for volume.
Yeah.
Well, that's where we've got the opportunity. I mean, there's a lot in common with the system, the satellite receiver, and our own TV sets. Yeah. We think we've got a strength in that we can react fairly quickly. We can provide a set that's value for money. It's not a Bang & Olufsen kind of, which sells in small numbers. Ours sells in large numbers, and it's value for money. And therefore, I mean, if we've got that attitude, we can kind of get into the market reasonably quickly, buying in the parts that we've got to buy in, and we can make a very cost-effective effort at that.
The problem with buying in components or even semi-assembled products is vulnerability to changes in the currency markets. With Ronald Reagan refusing to increase dollar interest rates in Washington, the pound was still gaining strength. But today, the collective mind of the Fidelity management is on technology.
I think you want it as simple as possible, and that we've got to look at it as a total package so that we can sell them the dish, the mountings that are needed for that, whether it goes on the roof, on a wall, or just straight on the ground. We can then look at saying, right, we can set up a series of appointed distributors around the country who can install the system for a set fee.
But that defeats the sort of total package view.
We give we then give the customer the choice. They can buy their package, and then for an added premium, whatever it needs to be, they can then either elect to set the whole thing up themselves. We could set up an advisory service to advise them if they do get problems, or they just pay a set fee and a chap comes along and installs it all for them.
Excited by a positive discussion, they try to price the dream.
Anyway, Richard, what price are you going to bet at on in the first year?
First year, to get a reasonable volume, high volume.
What's it going to be? What are we going to put it out at?
I would say a good ballpark price to go for is $499.
$499. All right. Martin is going to pass?
I don't know, but it's as good a target as any other.
It's
a better target than $199.
$499?
Gosh, you guys aren't even making it a horse race.
$499 retail.
$499. I reckon it's going to be $599 for a start. First year. What are we going to call the project, guys?
Pie in the Sky.
October 1987. Output at Fidelity is at full tilt. The run-up to Christmas is on, and their bargain 14-inch color sets are in high demand. Then, on Monday the 19th of October, the stock market crashed.
Another 44 billion off the market as the plunge continues.
There were some very worried people in the city today, the share dealers acting on behalf of investment clients whose panic and fear were all too evidently driving share prices down.
From the opening bell, Wall Street was on a record downslide, pushed along by the bad news from London. At times it looked like a financial disaster as frenzied selling threatened to overwhelm the system. When Once again, computer cell programs reacted to the falling index, adding millions of sell orders to the lists, contributing to the plunge.
If you take that in 1984, if Korea exported a television to England at $125 per television, the exchange rate was about 110 at that time. So that television landed in this country for about £110. In 1987, the exchange rate is 180, and Korean price of television has come down, not gone higher. So even taking the same price, $125, the same television is $125 converted at 180, roughly about £72. So where Koreans have not lost one penny from their pocket by exporting at the same price, they are able to push that television at £38 cheaper in England. Now, which means in order to compete with that product, I have to find an additional margin of £38 in a £100 item.
Shaving £38 off the cost of an already rock-bottom Fidelity set is the new priority. Gone is the expansion, gone is the Conran set, gone is the satellite receiver. For Swaraj Paul, duty now means survival.
To flow wherever metal moves against metal. To clean, lubricate, and protect today's petrol, diesel, and turbocharged engines demands an oil of superlative quality. Protect your engine with Esso Superlube, the striped protector. Quality at work.
This is the man who secured a brand new car without exhausting his capital or running up an overdraft or acquiring it as part of a job package. This is the man who secured a brand new car by paying monthly, with all his service and maintenance costs met not by him, but by Volkswagen, courtesy of their private contract scheme. Drop into your local dealer and find out how he can help you run a Volkswagen. On Volkswagen.
You're going to win the pools, right?
No.
You have a rich uncle I don't know about?
No.
An oil well in the garden, perhaps?
No, Dad, look.
So in the absence of these things, you might consider a fallback position?
A what?
I mean a pension.
A pension?
Yes, a pension. This is a very simple thing to find out about. So simple, even you can do it. You go into the Midland Bank, you'll recognise it. It has this big sign on it that says Midland Bank.
Ha ha.
You tell the guy all about yourself. In your case, this will not take too long. He listens to you like you're a very interesting person. He tells you which pension plan works best for you.
Say I don't like the look of any of them.
The point is, you do something. And you do it now. I don't want you to end up being a burden to my grandson. OK?
OK.
Give him here. There you go.
Midland Pensions. For details, call in at your local branch or ring 0800 400 469.
Studio line from L'Oreal. Sculpt, hold, control, mousse that shape. buddy, that's great. Fixing spray, fix quick for tricks, spritz, lift.
Style your hair any way you like it. Studio line.
Shut your eyes.
Nice. Sort of.
Like wholemeal bread.
As if.
It has the goodness of the whole grain in every flake.
Could I.
Have a bowl?
You took the words right out of my mouth.
Kellogg's Nutri-Grain, wholly delicious.
Fidelity, November 1987. Richard Hanna's earlier investment, a new flow line for circuit board assembly, is helping to improve quality. The new in-house designed 20-inch digital television is in production. It has been designed to develop with the market. Eventually, it will have stereo sound, a flatter, squarer tube, and a picture-in-picture facility.
3,000 square feet of bargains. See for yourself, we're in these.
This type of digital technology is ahead of the market. The consumer reaction has been good, and a major retailer has ordered a sample batch of sets, simply adding their Japanese-sounding brand name. But as the workforce calmly struggled to meet demand, the financial crisis finally breaks in the boardroom with the first hints of closure.
When last time we were here, we looked at the manufacturing cost, and decision on that day should have been to just close the factory, if that is what we were going to do. There is no sense whatsoever in running the factory for one day. The cheapest proposition would be to close this. We have been living in a luxury which we can't afford.
Sraj Paul's otherwise profitable group of companies is now in danger of hemorrhaging through Fidelity. Together with the management, he has come up with a plan which he hopes will save the Fidelity name. They have 1 year, 1988. To turn it around.
Personally, I am prepared to live with for a year and see if we can perform. Plus, it gives us a year to look at what other products we can bring into the factory, which can give us a better margin. I also told Alan, no way I am going to look at any capital expenditure because I just don't want to throw good money after bad.
Part of the burden for the turnaround demanded by Sraj Paul falls on the production director, Alan Edwards.
When I've had a look and seen what we want to do for next year, what I've said is that we would work a different number of hours at the beginning of the year to that we're going to work at the end. And that we'd maintain our labour to run two lines with the chassis lines that are required to keep those two lines going. And that would give us about 225 direct operators on the shop floor. They would work 33 hours a week in the first part of the year, and they would work 47 hours a week in the back end of the year. And what that would mean is that we would work Monday through Thursday. We'd have a 3-day week on the front end.
It's a complex plan, but for the workforce, it's simple. Inconvenient working hours and redundancies.
You know, we're not going to get away with this plan without some redundancy of our labour. We have currently about 260 full-time employees on the shop floor, and I want to get it down to something in the order of about 230. Maybe I'm going to have more than that because we're not going to spend money on capital on the chassis shop, which is a major problem, maybe I need to discuss that with you privately. I don't know how to get around one of the problems I'm going to have on the new designs. So it means that we could well have 30 people redundant on the shop floor, and there could be another 20 or 30 redundant elsewhere.
For Hanna, with his expansionist mentality, this is a depressing moment.
They've got husbands and the like. Now, I don't know how that's going to be perceived. But at the end of the day, if we don't do that, we're going to close down.
20 people are still missing in the devastating.
For the Fidelity management, the plan offers a last chance to instill an industrial culture and discipline into the Acton workforce. Discipline for its own sake is meaningless for the Hindu and the Zen Buddhist. Discipline, as Sraj Paul says, is duty, a necessity for life. For Hannah, lack of duty and discipline causes cracks in the new 20-inch sets, which means they have to be resprayed before leaving the factory.
And if we don't make a cultural change in their attitude to work and whether they wear headsets and this and all that sort of thing, I think a lot of our effort will founder. And we've discussed this. We know, yeah, we know it's a problem, but it's going to be a bit difficult to install. But I feel if we don't do that, we will not succeed just because we've cut numbers of people.
All right. It's not something which can be easily achieved. But on the other hand, we are looking at it. Is there any other option? We are looking at it on no different option basis.
We have looked at this over a long period of time now, and we believe that this is the best option that we have for survival over the next few years. And this is the start of it.
The option is to split Fidelity in two, a trading company and a manufacturing company. The trading company would sell everything the Acton factory makes, as well as being free to buy in cheaper foreign-built products to fill gaps in the market. The manufacturing company would operate a more flexible workforce, expanded when times are good, reduced when times are bad.
I think we've proved to ourselves, with the way that imports come into this country, that we cannot produce, which has been our bread and butter, the 14-inch portable television at a cost-competitive price. Especially with the way the dollar's gone compared to the pound, it is very cheap to bring in these products from the Far East at present, and people are doing it. And all of a sudden, not all of a sudden, but over a course of a year, we have seen our advantage, if you like, eroded. And our main bread and butter line, which is we are the largest producer of small screen television in the country, being taken away. And that's a fact we've got to face. And it's something we can't continue to do in next year. So we're going to have to change what the factory makes. And that involves less people.
In spite of the fact that we have been very open with the workers and the staff, etc., I don't really think that they have understood the problems of Fidelity and how difficult it is to keep that business going. Now, otherwise, in a company which is sort of almost sinking, there is no reason that we should have absenteeism of 9, 10, 12%. There is no reason that people just do not take the attitude that quality must be perfect. If you have to rerun the product and reject at quality level, that reduces your productivity.
When I look at my factory, I think, well, it's not particularly efficient, but it could be. The people work hard, but that is not the problem. The problem is we're not selling our product for the right price outside there.
Like all crises in industry, Fidelity's difficulties are a complex cocktail of missed opportunities, runaway successes, and plain bad luck. Caparo have rationalized the Fidelity product line, increased quality, and invested money in the future. But the Christmas of 1987 was not to be a happy one for management or workers. Early January 1988 saw a further batch of job losses. The final straw for the Fidelity workforce and their team of shop stewards, many of whom took voluntary redundancy. Senior shop steward Trevor Johnson.
There's nothing that this particular administration can blame this workforce for. Nothing. This workforce have produced and cannot produce even the Korean or the Japanese when given the parts and the proper equipment to do so. Because we have been in this business for a very long time. There's people here who have done more than 25 years in this business, and we have picked up the skills longer than most of these new Japanese companies that is coming up. But the point of view is that the workforce is at the present is just fed up and say, look, we have done everything for them, and there again, we're getting nowhere, we have got no job security, we have got nothing.
Well, it stands to reason. You go to get a television set from any of these shops, Curry's, Dixon's, there's I doubt if you'll see a Fidelity television set or a British-made television set. It's all Korean stuff, Japanese stuff, stuff from any place apart from England itself. And the people who are actually producing in England, like Fidelity, it's pointless. They're competing against people that the government are actually helping, because that's what it boils down to. They're helping them to put companies like Fidelity out of business.
There's one fact, I think, that caused this situation, well, within the country, is that the people way of changing is very hard. They don't want to change their attitude. And I think that's what's keeping back this country. I mean, you don't have to look at the Japanese to say, well, they've done this that way and it worked. It's nothing to do what it, it's nothing to say because the Japanese done that. It's a one-to-one base. Our person feel like seeing something and trying it, putting himself out to try it to see if it will work. But this country hold back. They're trying to invest. In other words, they wait for somebody else to make the move and hope it works. Then they all jump on and follow. And I think that's the mistake this country is making.
There is a cultural problem, I think, with the workforce in the manufacturing unit. But they are not the problem. Given the material and the plan, I've seen them producing as hard as I've seen anyone work in this country. That is not the problem. I believe the problem has been not getting to grips upstairs here with the problems of new product innovation and new product design at an early enough stage, so that we have not had the right products working properly to meet the market need.
Worldwide, not only in the TV field, but in all the aspects of machine production. Now, we look to the future, we say, where's the factory going? It's only a few years ago we were celebrating the 1 millionth television set being produced off our production lines. Now, we are reaching the stage very shortly where we're almost reaching far in excess of that. In fact, nearly 1 million a year before long. That's where we must aim to get. But we can only get there one way, and that's by using our most important asset. And the most important asset we have is not the machinery or equipment, conveyors or robots we may put on the lines. The most important asset we have are you people stood in front of me now. You are the people that can only make us achieve what our aims are for the future. To do that, you must have a pride in your company. You must take an interest in what's going on around you. Those people who had awards just now in the suggestion scheme, most of those are awards given for the work they do every day. But they've looked at that work and said, how can I improve it? How can I cut costs? How can I speed it up? And it's by this effort and this continued effort that we are going to progress. We are already the biggest employer in the Cardiff area. We are growing, but we only grow by your efforts.
That weekly pep talk costs Matsushita about 90 colour television sets. It is considered good value by a management and workforce almost entirely British. Panasonic is British, but it is not in Acton. To the Japanese, South Wales was like a tax-free island. General development grants, low rates, and a brand new and willing workforce ready to take up Zen and the art of TV manufacture. That is how it started. Twelve years on, the investment has paid off, not financially, but in enabling Japan's biggest electrical manufacturer to penetrate the European markets. These sets are for the Spanish market. They are effectively prototypes. Before they go into production, they must face the closest scrutiny from the Japanese and British management. For Panasonic and Matsushita, quality and the pursuit of it is an obsession. Panasonic realizes that the TV market is saturated with products from the developing Far Eastern countries. Even in Wales, they have diversified into making microwave ovens and typewriters, ensuring the future of the Panasonic name. Manufacturing director Colin Leahy has been with Panasonic in Wales since the beginning. He is not a religious man, but he has a zen-like preoccupation with detail, technology, and quality.
Well, what we're looking at is the basic chassis, and this is part of the chassis alignment. So in actual fact, this is the main printed circuit board, and it is a working television without the cathode ray tube. In order to maximize the efficiency of the main assembly lines, and as part of our quality block assurance system, we do all the possible offline alignments away from the main assembly area. There are alignments which have to be done at the main assembly when the cathode ray tube is actually matched to the chassis. But other than that, we can find out probably more than 95% of rejects at this stage, rather than interfere with the main assembly build. Also, we have to change our chassis about every 18 months in order to keep up with technology and in order to rationalize component counts down to the level you see here.
A higher degree of automation means that there is less room for human error. But at Panasonic, checking quality is the responsibility of all workers at every level.
This is the first time we checked the completed set for its functions. I should point out that at this stage, the set is not finally aligned. So it's purely a functional check to make sure the picture, sound, brightness, color is all operating correctly. After this inspection, the sets will go overhead up onto an aging section for 120 minutes, soak test. During the 120 minutes, they're at a higher rated voltage and all the controls are operated at maximum as well. This is primarily to make sure the set is in the operating temperature before final adjustment later on in the process.
At Panasonic, the customer is always the first consideration. Workers on the line here are encouraged to regard their colleagues as their customers in the next part of the manufacturing process.
I've talked to design about the possibility of a different type connection. At the moment, they're looking into it, but I think we need to have a look at some immediate countermeasure for it.
Can't you put it on the H-boards?
The workforce at Panasonic are encouraged to contribute actively to the management of the area that they work in. This quality circle group has representatives from manual insertion workers up to management.
This hole here is the screw hole where it goes onto the chassis frame. This one is just auto to insert locating pin, right?
Genuine manufacturing design problems are solved, saving Matsushita thousands of pounds and making a better product.
Yeah, well, you've got to think of something permanent, but this is a temporary measure until you can come up with something.
To the untrained eye, it is simply a television set in a cardboard box. But what makes a TV into a quality product is not the name or even the undoubtedly high level of technology that goes into its manufacture. A television set from South Wales is a quality product because it now comes from a culture, almost a religion, that sees quality as a duty to the customers whose lives it will enhance. January the 15th, 1988. Fidelity's 14-inch production line continues to produce, fulfilling orders placed before Christmas. Its days are numbered. Upstairs, product planning director Richard May has found a manufacturer in Hong Kong to produce the new Fidelity 14-inch set. Employing an outside design consultancy, the existing Chinese chassis called Superstar has been restyled and updated in less than 2 weeks. It's hardly the Conran set, But for Richard May, at least, it's what the customer wants.
We had already done a lot of research into what people were looking for in a product, so we knew in our own minds what we wanted to achieve. So it was a case of a evolutionary step forward rather than a revolution. And in fact, the design we'd previously done working with Conran was really a revolution in design. We were trying to take design a long way forward. And unfortunately, the results of the market research that we carried out at that time showed us that, in fact, the general consumer, the people buying this sort of product, don't actually want a revolution in design. They want something that looks nice, that will match and blend in with their home environment, but won't be totally different.
Of course, the new 14-inch set will cost Fidelity less to produce. The average monthly wage of the Chinese worker who will make it would only pay a worker at the Acton factory for 2 days. Whilst May was looking for a factory in the Far East to build the 14-inch set, he was also looking for a suitable factory to build Fidelity's newest product, the 20-inch digital set. The workers at Acton got used to seeing businessmen from the Far East pass through the reception area. Little short of a miracle would be needed to make the dollar strong again and therefore save the Acton factory. Fidelity's workforce felt they had nothing left to negotiate with. They became impatient and demoralized. On Monday, the 25th of January, Alan Edwards called the workforce together to make an announcement.
I suppose the main thing that has happened is that we started negotiating with the union in November. We didn't get any agreement with the union. The economic climate has not changed, particularly, I mean, the dollar is still fairly weak against the pound. But I think if you look at the marketplace, consumer spending seems to have dropped right off compared with what it was at the end of last year. And that, together with the union not agreeing with the packages that we put to them, has caused Sir Raj Paul to have lack of confidence in what Fidelity can do. And that's why we have had to relook and revamp our plans. And right now, this week, we announced the closure of the manufacturing unit.
We've tried as long as possible to continue the manufacturing here. To be honest, against the odds, because not only were we suffering from product coming in from the Far East at very low prices, from certain countries such as China, there is a quota. You can't bring in that many sets, but all the sets that do come in free of duty. And the duty imposed on a TV is 14%. And yet, we as a manufacturer in London have to pay duty on any components we import. Now, unfortunately, a fact of life, there is no factory in the UK manufacturing 14-inch tubes. So we have to import them, and we have to pay duty on every one of those tubes. So we're being penalised. And it means that on the retail price of the product, that can amount to up to £20 difference.
I have no doubt whatsoever in my mind that we would have been very profitable but for the exchange rate. And this exchange rate has really killed the whole business.
For Richard Hanna, it is the end of 4 years of firefighting at Fidelity. But as managing director, there are still decisions to be made and realities to be faced.
I don't see the possibility of manufacturing in economically sensible terms in this factory continuing much past the June-July period. In terms of using the trade name Fidelity and in selling the product on an imported basis, there is some opportunity. But even there, the margins are so thin compared to the capital you have to invest, because you pay for them when they leave the country of origin and you have to finance them for the months they're on the sea and before you sell them. That capital tied up is substantial and the returns on it are low. In fact, you could argue it's probably better to leave your money in the bank with a friendly bank manager and go and lie on the beach, because you'd do better.
Or if I really take out right from the beginning and to this thing, I think our loss should be anywhere between 15 to 20 million pounds. And so that's what really lost.
Certainly by the end of 1988, I would be expecting not to be working here in Fidelity. The size of the job at that time would be such that I would not be too interested in continuing in a similar role. And I think I would be an overhead burden on Fidelity at that time.
At essence, it's management failure. It's got to be. Management takes the responsibility for an operation. If it doesn't succeed, it's like the coach of a football team. He's to blame in the end analysis. Obviously, there are outside factors that influence. But that's the task, is to see how can you work around those and find a solution that might operate. We haven't been able to do that. We're in good company. Nobody else has been. No other English manufacturers found how to do it.
The second award is to Margaret Holborn from Preparation 2. Margaret's idea was a little bit of market research. When, as you may know, on some of the compo models, we used to put a refractor in there for the sound. She found that people very rarely use this refractor, so she put the suggestion forward it be left off the sets in future. So Margaret Holborn, please. One of the biggest problems areas we have is
the... You can make all the excuses in the world, but a failure is a failure, in my book. And management is the one people responsible. It's not the workers. We get paid to make things work. If they don't work, we fail. It's that simple.
The next award goes to Pam Viney for her suggestion on identification and clarification of those models which have similar parts in them. So Pam Viney, please. Next award is to Stephen May. Stephen's suggestion was for the layout and design of storage boxes. Stephen May, please. Now, the next award is to Aidan Brown. He has, in fact, three awards coming to him. The first one is for a backup scheme for the PT-88 competition we have at the present. The second award has gone to Aidan, is for his layout of instruction sheets and changing the instruction sheet method. And the third award has gone for Aidan's ideas and drawings on a new back cover conveyor system. Aidan Brown, please.
An illustrated booklet with articles on all the Equinox programmes in this series is now available. For your copy, please send a cheque or postal order for £2.50, payable to Channel 4, to Equinox, P.O. Box 4000, London W36XJ, or Glasgow G12 9JQ, or Belfast BT2 7FE. Well, on ITV in a few minutes, Clive James on television. Here on 4, the final film in the series Virtuoso, in which musicians discuss their work. Vladimir Ashkenazi talks with Jonathan Miller before playing Robert Schumann's Étude Symphonique. And that's next.